Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to our Kollegium Talk. This is the second event in the series organized by the Helsinki Kollegium for Advanced Studies. And we are very happy to be here today and discussing our research. I'm Maria Kuteeva. I'm an Eric Allard Fellow at the Helsinki Kollegium for Advanced Studies and Professor of English Linguistics at Stockholm University. In the last 15 years, my research has focused on the use of English in multilingual academic settings. But during my PhD back in the 90s, I also looked at how the science of language emerged in the early 19th century and became a discipline in its own right in Britain. But today our focus is on the question of language error. Why are we so afraid of making mistakes? And where does this anxiety come from? To discuss this exciting topic from two perspectives, I'd like to introduce my colleagues, Masha Khachaturyan and Svetlana Vetchinnikova. They're both core fellows at the HCAS. And now I'd like you to say a few words about yourselves and your research backgrounds. Masha.
Thank you, Maria. I'm a linguistic field worker, and I have been doing field work in West Africa for about 12 years now. And I am interested in the language use in its social-cultural context and the influence of context of interaction on language, which language in particular I will talk about in a minute. I have looked in my career into the language of Christian conversion as one of those contexts, and more recently I became interested in language socialization.
Yeah, my background is actually pretty diverse, and this is something that I'd like to draw on in our today's discussion. In my PhD, I looked at phraseological patterns in second language acquisition and use. But then I also worked for a project on English as lingua franca and language change. And for the last several years, I have been involved in a collaborative project with neuroscientists looking at how speech is processed in real time in the brain. Currently in the Kollegium, I'm working on a project which is kind of trying to draw on all of these strands together. This is on individual variation and how we can look at individual variation both from the point of view of processing and from the point of view of language use.
Thank you. So people usually come out of school with an idea that language is a set of rules. Yeah. Language errors are penalized in examinations and in other high-stakes communication domains. As Bourdieu put it, standard language acquires, quote, the force of law in and through the educational system. Juxtaposing linguistic description and prescription in his lecture to the British Academy, David Dennison also remarked that, quote, it's all very well pointing out vagueness, variation, and difficulty, but in a school context, what is usually expected is clear guidance on right and wrong. Teachers, pupils, and ministers of state are presumably united on that point. So for those of us who work at university, the idea of normativity in language use is deeply ingrained. What we tend to forget is that on a large scale, language standardization is a relatively new phenomenon. It has developed over the last centuries, or two centuries or so, in connection to nation building projects and dictionary compilation. For example, in the 19th century, there was a trend to compile the first dictionaries and descriptive grammars, like das Deutsches Wörterbuch by the Brothers Grimm. And that also, that kind of trend reached Britain with the compilation of the new, or what we know today as the Oxford English Dictionary. For over a century now, the OED has been documenting the use of the English language, and it regularly selects the word of the year, which reflects current trends in language use. But its creation also coincided and even contributed to language standardization and introduction of literacy on a mass scale, particularly later in the 20th century. Bakhtin has described this centripetal trend as unitary language, contrasting it with the messy reality of heteroglossia, or diversity in speech and language stratification on the professional, social, generational, and other levels. So traditionally, standard language has been closely associated with written language and with speech of the educated classes. And a great deal of linguistic research has also taken this standard written language as its point of departure and even contributed to idealizing the native speaker as a natural user of this type of language. At the same time, linguists also draw a distinction between standard of usage and standard of norm. In other words, what is common in language or what is okay to say and what is legitimate and prestigious. So this distinction somewhat obscures the concept of language error. So my question to you is, so how do you understand error in your research? Can you tell me a little bit about your perspectives on this matter?
Thank you. Thank you. So my perspective on this matter comes from my own empirical research on the language that is called Mano, and it is spoken in Guinea in Liberia, where I've been doing field work. And my initial interest in the language was through the perspective of a project on grammar writing. And so grammar as a sort of a setting things how they are in the language obliges the grammar writer to make particular choices. So to begin with, it's the choice of whom do we get the information about the language from. So who is a good speaker of language? Is this someone who has the language as his or her dominant language? Does she need to have both parents speaking this language, what kind of community she's from should be like, et cetera, et cetera. So this is the first choice. So oftentimes we eliminate second language speakers, for example, as a source of information about the language. Then another question is, so we ask questions, specific questions about the language, what is okay to say and what's not. And then we contrast this to natural recordings of the language. And oftentimes, these two things are in contrast. So you can find certain patterns in spoken use, but the speakers will explicitly deny that it's a good form of language. An example could be different kinds of contractions. Like in English, you can compare it with the contraction of don't, it's do, plus not regularly contracts to don't, and you can even find it in writing. But a similar contraction in the Mano language would be judged as not as good as a non-contracted form, for example, although it is very common in speech. So what should I do about it in the grammar? How should I describe it? And then, this becomes the question of norm of use and then some normative judgments of the speaker. So this was my first encounter with the problem of the norm, and it actually continues because grammar writing is a never-ending process. Even the grammar of English continues to be rewritten. But more recently, I became interested in more and more interested in different kinds of speakers of the language. So you can have here on the right, it would be this good speaker of language, Mano, whose mother and father speak this language. And to the left, it is his brother-in-law, who is married to his sister. So he's exposed to the language through his wife, but also grew up in a multilingual community and speaks the language as well. But his dominant language, his main language, is Kpelle, so it's another indigenous language. I'm very interested in the way he speaks the language then. But I'm even more interested in the way their children speak the language, because they grow bilingual and they get different kinds of input from different adults and other children. Speaking a language in this area is in a very complex relationship with having a particular ethnolinguistic identity. So if you have your Mano father, you are supposed to speak Mano properly. But what does it mean to speak the language properly is a very interesting and controversial thing. And there are lots of discussions behind the backs of people of how they speak it. So I have an example of a priest who has a Mano mother, and he's a very good speaker in my uneducated view, but people all the time discuss his linguistic performance and say that he's not a very good speaker, so he doesn't speak properly. And so I'm interested in seeing how children develop into good speakers of language, how they learn to differentiate different kinds of input that they get, how profoundly their linguistic performance gets restructured over time as they learn, and so what are the drivers of this restructuring? Is the social pressure of the social norms are the main? Yes, and this would be my children who I'm interested in. Are the norms, the social norms are the main driver of this restructuring, or maybe it's a purely language internal process. So that would be my take on it.
Thank you. Svetlana, what about you?
Yeah, as a linguist interested in cognitive processing, I thought I'd try to bring a cognitive perspective on language error. So what's a language error from the perspective of cognitive processing? The current understanding in cognitive science that brains are essentially prediction machines. I have a quote there from Andy Clark's paper, but really there are multiple different theories of predictive processing, of predictive coding out there in cognitive science. Brain scientists and cognitive scientists do not necessarily agree on how exactly this process is implemented in the brain, but in general, overall, the process seems to be pretty clear. So instead of processing the world or things that happen to us as they happen, we all the time predict what's going to happen and then just assess whether our predictions are confirmed or not confirmed. And then what remains to be done is just to work with the prediction error. So you don't need to process all of the information, you only need to process that difference between what you predicted and what actually happened. So again, what do we do as prediction machines? We predict what's going to happen, then we see what happens. Does it match what we predicted? If yes, well, we don't need to do anything. But if no, then that means we get a signal, the prediction error signal, and we need to update the model. So from this perspective, then, error is a mismatch between the expected and the encountered. What about language error, then? Language is no exception. In language, we process language by prediction as well, and fortunately, language is predictable at multiple different levels. We can predict the specific words that we're going to hear, but we can also predict the semantic field from which the words can come or their syntactic feature. So for example, when I gave a question out there on the slide, does it match? And then one of the options was yes, I'm sure that the other option you predicted was no, but what you actually saw on the slide was error. So that's something that probably did not confirm your expectation in certain ways. So if you predicted specifically the word no, that was a prediction error, but you could also predict, could have also predicted something that's kind of a contrastive answer to the question, does it match? Yes, no, not really, something like this. Right, so in fact, brain scientists have various different methods that can measure the prediction error, and there is a lot of research that has been done on different kinds of violations and anomalies in language. Let's look at an example. So here, if you hear a sentence such as, after a long period of drought, the forecast finally called for, and then probably don't expect to hear sun, because if it has already been dry for quite a long time, then sun is the last thing we want there. So this here you probably experience a prediction error signal, which means that this is not some you did not expect to hear to see sun, but this is what happened. This is what you encounter. In this case, brain scientists see an effect which is called an N400. This is kind of a spike in electrical activity of the brain that happens 400 milliseconds after the event. So after, basically after you see the word sun, there is an effect that can be seen at the brain level. Since you did not expect to see sun, the amplitude of that effect is pretty large. So, and the amplitude of the effect then shows how surprising the event was. And in that case, it was pretty surprising. And in this case, you need to update your internal system. So, which basically means that the next time you are more likely to expect sun there. Well, a little bit, but this is how what the model predicts. In contrast to this, if you hear a sentence such as after a long period of rain, the forecast finally called for, then you, in that case, you are probably much more likely to expect to hear or see sun there. And in this case, we still see an N400 effect, but its amplitude is much, much smaller because sun is something that you predict that's going to happen. So there is no need to make a large update of your expectations in this case. So from this perspective, then, prediction error is a matter of degree. So how surprising is the event that you encounter? Is it something that you expected to happen, or is it something you did not expect to happen, and to what extent you did not expect it to happen? A matter of degree.
Thank you. So now we come to context dependency. We all know that language use is context dependent. There is, of course, register variation of different kinds, particularly between written and spoken language. We have different speaker profiles, which encompass factors like age, gender, class, etc. There are also differences when a language is used by speakers who share it as their first language or don't share it and use it as an additional language. So how does this context matter? Can you say something about contextual variation?
Yeah, definitely. So that would be common sense that if we process language by prediction, then we probably take in all information into account in making our predictions, in making expectations of what's going to happen. And this contextual information is something that we must be taking into account as well. That would be probably common sense. Do we see it at the brain level? Does the context matter? So, right. Here are a few examples from a, well, recent, more or less recent experiment. Here, the same sentence was read to listeners by different voices. And you could see that the sentence was more surprising if the speaker reading the sentence was inconsistent with what the sentence said. So, for example, the sentence, "If only I looked like Britney Spears in her latest video," was more surprising to the listeners when it was read by a male voice than when it was read by a female voice. Or another example, a sentence, "I have a large tattoo on my back," was more surprising to the listeners when it was read with an upper class voice, whatever it is. And then again, the sentence, "Every evening I drink some wine before going to sleep," was more surprising when it was read by a child than an adult. In all those cases, it was possible to see the effect at the brain, that N400 effect, which where the amplitude was larger for the more surprising contextual embedding. Masha, can you comment on these examples from the social linguistic point of view?
Yeah, so it's certainly very key and very important things for social linguistics. Class, gender, and age, these are all parameters that social linguistics has taken into account for all the decades that research has been done within the framework. But it's also interesting and important to keep in mind that people are not classified into some kinds of boxes once and for all. And so there's a lot of flexibility, actually, in linguistic behavior of people. And so lower class and upper class, even if there are some correlates in linguistic behavior, people are able to shift their language. It is called style shifting if you use more, let's say, upper class features in your speech in particular circumstances, such as formal circumstances, interview or other context like this. Also, when it comes to gender, of course, it's not either or. It's not black and white. So here we have some cultural figures that are associated with, let's say, female sphere or whatnot, conventionally or stereotypically. But then, of course, things can be much more complex. In the same domain, female and male speech can be different, also quite formally different in languages where, for example, there's gender marking. So where speakers are obliged to make specific choices of markers, female or male, indexing themselves as speakers. But then something interesting happens. So there's a study by Kirahol, for example, of linguistic performance of social identity of hijras, a transgender category in Hindi. In India. So Hindi has this feature of almost obligatory gender marking, at least in many contexts it becomes obligatory. And then in the one of the features of transgender speech is using female markers instead of male markers. And so this is where people adopt linguistically a particular sociolinguistic identity. And then the question is, it's probably unexpected to the addressees to hear female markers by particular people. But then it all comes in a package of a sort. So it's not only speech, it's also bodily behavior, it's also particular ways of dressing, etc., etc. And so would it be, if it's just this isolated thing, a male voice saying, if only I looked like Britney Spears in her latest video, that's one thing. Or if it were Hindi, if the same male voice used a female agreement marker, that would probably spike a particular error signal. But in our daily life, we know we are immersed in this diversity and flexibility. And if it all comes in a package of a sort, does this become then so unexpected?
Yeah, a very, very good question, a very, very good point. Indeed, prediction error is then defined based on what kind of expectations we have. But we make our expectations based on our own experience. And each one of us has very different experience. So something can be unexpected for one person and pretty expected for a different person. Plus, another very important thing is that predictive processing is the same process that's also used for learning. So again, another very influential theory in cognitive science is error-driven learning. So basically the same prediction error that draws our attention to something that's unexpected in what we are experiencing is the same phenomenon that makes us learn new things. So basically, for the first time, something can very well be unexpected, but once you experience it again, and perhaps again and again, you adapt to it and you learn it. So because the prediction error makes you update your model, and once you are and if you experience the same thing several times, then your model is already pretty well adjusted to minimize the prediction error next time. So the next time you hear it, you're going to take it into your stride. And indeed, it's a very good point that it's not all fixed and pretty fluid, but our cognitive mechanism seems to be pretty well adapted to process such kinds of changes and such kind of fluidity.
Yeah. Well, many examples of language use out of context come from formal settings where less formal or correct language is used, so to speak, and in research that often deals with educational settings. But language use can also be perceived as erroneous and confusing when so-called higher or formal registers are used in lower register contexts. There's one example I still recall from my youth in St. Petersburg in the 90s. That was a kind of troublesome period, and street crime was quite common. And in the evenings, there were sometimes groups of teenage boys mugging people on their way home. So quite accidentally, I discovered that using high registers and very formal forms of address and the honorific pronoun we had an unexpected effect and completely took them by surprise and left them at a loss because they were not expecting to be spoken to in this kind of language. So in this situation, there was no language error as such, but these kind of petty criminals were still confused. They got the same error message as you described from being exposed to these formal registers in the context where they didn't expect them and to be addressed in a formal way. So
yeah,
that is an interesting,
really, really great example of how something which is standard can actually be unexpected in a given context. So it does look like context matters quite a lot. Then there is another context that perhaps probably interests all of us, and that's the context of multilingual environments where non-native speakers speak a certain language. For example, perhaps our use of Finnish here in Finland as non-native speakers of Finland, or the use of English as a non-native language, and nowadays English is spoken as a non-native language by far more people than it is spoken by native speakers. So can we adapt to non-native speech? That's another context that would be of interest to us. It looks like we can. Here's one experiment from cognitive neuroscience again, where this experiment was held in Dutch, so the listeners in the experiment were Dutch speakers. And in Dutch, there is gender marking. So there are two genders, neuter and common genders, if I'm not mistaken, in Dutch. I don't speak Dutch. But if you have gender in a language, it means that you have to follow the rules of gender agreement. So, for example, adjectives and nouns have to agree in gender. In this case, there are specific determiners that are associated with a specific gender. And what the researchers did in this experiment, they read the sentences with and without gender agreement. And certainly, when the sentence was read with a gender agreement error, then it generated a prediction error signal in the brain. In this case, peak 600 effect in native speakers. But importantly, these sentences with gender agreement error were read by Dutch native speakers first, and this resulted in the usual P600 effect, the usual effect that's observed in response to syntactic grammatical errors in speech. But when the same sentences were read by non-native speakers, by a non-native speaker voice with a clear foreign accent, then the effect was reduced. So it looks like, yes, we can take it into account that we are now listening to a non-native speaker, and errors are perhaps more common in such speech, so we don't really have to draw attention to them. And this is visible even at the neuronal level.
Mm. Yeah, to reformulate this observation a bit differently, maybe we are we somehow expect those errors, right, in the non-native speech, and we are not that surprised by them. And also pushing it a little bit further, maybe we tolerate errors in the speech of someone who is obviously not a native speaker. And in that regard, I'd like to give an example from my field work. So this is to present you the family I stay with and work with. Again, the same children. Maybe you recognize the girl in the center. So I was working inside the house with my main language consultant's cousin, and I was trying to figure out again, so for this project of grammar writing, etc., I was trying to figure out a particular construction in the Mano language. And there were some contradictory normativity, grammaticality judgments. They would say that it's possible to say a certain thing, and then they would change their mind, and they would go back and forth all the time. And then there were, again, I would compare it with the actual use, and I couldn't figure out what's like right or, and what's wrong, and where this variation comes from, most importantly. And so at some point, I was so tired of it, I went to sit on that porch, and I started to just randomly ask around the how would you say she's washing herself, because this is the construction I was interested in, this reflexive marking. And there was the girl whom you here you can see her on the right of the picture, and she was passing by, and she just dropped a sentence, a translation of this into Mano. And the way she used the construction, the way she formulated her answer was precisely this not correct way of saying it, or at least what I was thinking was not correct. And then I figured out what happened. So she is not a native speaker of the language. She her native language is Kpelle. She was born in a different village, and she came to live with the family only about a year or two prior to that conversation. She managed to acquire it and speak it quite proficiently, at least get herself understood. But she was not a native speaker, and she was making a lot of those non-native speaker mistakes. But she felt that she was in a position to teach me the language. So, which means that her non-native speech was tolerated, first of all, and that she thought that I could adopt the same kind of pattern, and it's okay for me, because both for her and for me, nobody sets very high standards, because, well, I'm obviously a non-native speaker, you can see it. And also, she is not a native speaker, and it's fine for her as well. So both of us being women in the family who are not born and raised in Mano families, we can speak with certain kinds of errors, and it is fine. We are tolerated as long as we get ourselves understood.
Right. So this brings us to our next question. So do errors hinder communication then?
A very good question, something that we're definitely very much interested in. If we as non-native speakers make errors, do they hinder communication? There has been research in English as lingua franca settings on misunderstandings, because in English as lingua franca settings, non-native speakers talk to other non-native speakers. And then basically in this scenario, you would expect more errors and perhaps more misunderstandings. But the research shows that no, misunderstandings are not more common or as common as you would expect them to be in English as lingua franca communication. Certainly, English as lingua franca communications also differ. Different non-native speakers talk to different non-native speakers in very different contexts, in very different environments, and with very different language levels of language proficiency. But still, in all of these different contexts, it seems like we're able to take context into account. We are able to make predictions of what the common ground between us is, and how much you can expect the same common ground from your interlocutor, what you can expect from your interlocutor, and you can adapt to this. And one thing that English as lingua franca research has shown is that we consciously use pragmatic strategies to preempt misunderstandings. So, for example, English as lingua franca speech has been shown to be more explicit. So, since you assume that it's possible that you will be misunderstood, or perhaps that misunderstandings might be more common in English as lingua franca, you make your speech more explicit. So you explain more details, for example, so that's in order to preempt misunderstandings. In that case, then misunderstandings perhaps might be even more common when you talk to your partner rather than to another non-native speakers, because when talking to you, somebody who is close to you, then you take a lot of things for granted, and you're not doing as much work to preempt any possible misunderstandings. So this is a very complex interplay between what kind of assumptions we make and how we are trying to counter possible problems in communication.
Right. And you could argue that this kind of process is not unique to English as a lingua franca. It would be the case in other lingua franca contexts, which are not necessarily of the same scale and don't necessarily involve communication in different parts of the world. If you think about, for example, how Swedish is used by people with migrant backgrounds, you could observe probably the same kind of trends in it. And so over the past couple of decades, there have been developments resulting in new varieties of Swedish, which can be probably explained by the same sort of lingua franca processes of, on the one hand, simplification and explicitness, but also, of course, the mixing of different languages and features from languages other than Swedish.
Absolutely. And in fact, from a certain perspective, it's even interesting that we notice mistakes or errors in the first place, because there is another area of cognitive research which shows that there are lots of weird things in language that we don't notice at all. So, for example, if I ask you, how many animals did Moses take on the ark? I bet you would answer two, because this is what participants in the experiment did, even though Moses is not the right person. And in that experiment, the participants were actually tested on their knowledge. Yes, they knew that it's Noah who was the right person. And when they were asked to repeat the question that was asked, they repeated it using Noah. They said, how many animals did Noah take on the ark? But they simply didn't notice that the original question was about Moses. They were simply able to answer two. And the same kind of illusions are observed with other interesting sentences, such as, the dog was bitten by the man who was bitten. And you would probably reply, well, the man, because you don't expect the dog to be bitten by the man. And despite the fact that this is not what the structure tells you, you kind of process it semantically. Or then another example, the book fills a much needed gap. Well, we don't need more gaps. We don't need gaps, do we? But in fact, if you Google that phrase, the book fills a much needed gap, you'll find examples used in actual book blurbs. Do try it out. So there are lots of things we don't notice, but at the same time, there are also things we do notice in a language. Why do we do that?
Yeah. Well, first of all, going back to that Moses problem, if you say how many animals did Jack take on the ark, probably that wouldn't be something that would be readily understood. So again, there are lots of things that are presupposed here. So Moses and Noah, they are both from that biblical realm. And so replacing one with the other probably doesn't change much. So maybe your interlocutor thinks that you made a slip of the tongue, but she understand what you meant. So again, it's all in context in a way. So it's not just a random mistake in a way. It's a very actually loaded mistake, and so misinterpretation doesn't arise precisely because it's not a random replacement. And so we perceive things in context, and it's then in context that we don't notice errors because they don't matter, like here, for example, or in contrast, certain minor things start to matter suddenly. And so indeed, we can be aware, so we can pass poor Moses make him pass unnoticed, but attend to very small phonetic or grammatical mistakes in the speech of our interlocutors. Mm-hmm. And it's an interesting thing that even, so taking an example of, for example, Scottish variety, which is known stereotypically, there are even postcards about it, that they pronounce cow as coo. And maybe you've seen this hairy brown car, which is typical of Scotland, and it's written COO, so like a coo, not a cow. And this is a typical thing of speech of Scots. And there's also an interesting thing about it, is that some people style shift. So they would use in informal context, they would use a cow coo, and then in formal context they would switch to cow. And there was an interesting study of small children from 2 to 4 years old and their caregivers, mothers usually, and the way, so they used these two variants, cow and coo, and in other hows and whos, for example. So with this particular variety, it's quite exceptional with other with respect to other variety variables that they studied, but I wanted to talk about it, even if it does not represent the entire picture, but still. So there would be a style shifting in the adult speech from coo in informal, like in play, for example, they would use more coo, and then when they would instruct their kids, they would use more cow. And their children, starting from the age of about 3, they would do the same thing. So their ears would be so finely tuned to the variation in the adult speech that they would also be able to replicate the same thing as 3 years old. It's quite impressive, I think. And there are interesting studies also going outside of Europe, in China, with Sui, a particular linguistic variety, and there are also clan sub-varieties. And children as young as 3 years old are able to distinguish between their father's variety and their mother's variety, and they're also instructed to speak like their fathers and not like their mothers. So again, a similar kind of problem that I alluded to when I spoke about Mano. And so there would be things, so a child, a 3 year old, would be seated on his mother's lap, and his mother, so a question would be asked from the interviewer, how do you say this thing? A mother would say in his ear the variant in her dialect, and the child would speak out with a variant of her father's dialect. So 3 years old are able to notice these kinds of differences and replicate them. And then again, the man was beaten by the dog. We just completely don't notice it.
That of course, brings us to a question. How do we put the boundaries about where one language ends and another begins? Because you could interpret that sort of variation as also like they're bidialectal, or you can, you know, use the term language to describe that kind of dialect. But can you also tell us a little bit more about your example in the U.S. About assist? That was a different situation, wasn't it?
Yeah. So you were talking about English as lingua franca, and as soon as I moved to Finland, here I still don't speak Finnish well enough to communicate at the university in particular. So I speak English, and everybody else around me speaks English. Is it because it's not a native language for all of us, that we are trying to accommodate each other, or it's because it's Finland and people are in general a bit more, relaxed is not a word. But anyway, I didn't have communication issues as much and anxiety about communication as much as I had in the US, where I came from, lived before coming to Finland. And so one of the things I still remember was in the beginning of my stay there, and I came to the United States from France, and it's quite an important thing for the discussion that. And because I wanted to sit in a class by an anthropology professor, and I wrote an email to her asking whether I could do it. And I said in my email, I wrote whether I can assist in her class, so to sit in. And it's because in French, to sit in a class or to study in a class, to take a class, is assister au cours. So I just immediately used the same word. But she was quite surprised and responded to me, no, I'm fine, I have my teaching assistants. So, and I, at first I didn't understand why she would say this, and then I understood, of course, it's not assist, it's attend. And yeah, and if you say assist, of course she doesn't need assistance. So it's to say that in the lingua franca context, yes, probably we are all on the same boat. But when you are as a non-native speaker, when you come to an environment where most of the people are either native speakers or, well, I'm not sure she was a native speaker of English, but much more proficient, and she had been living in the country for many years. So in any case, she couldn't have any clue to interpret my utterance as a mistake, saying assist instead of attend in the meaning of attend. So in the environment where you are surrounded by more proficient speakers, there's certainly more place for misunderstanding.
Right. That also illustrates the fact that we don't necessarily only transfer from our first languages. In fact, if you are proficient or not proficient, but at least familiar with several languages, it's quite likely that you will have cross-linguistic transfer between additional languages rather than your first language when it comes to that sort of errors. There's a whole field of third language acquisition that deals with that kind of research.
Yeah, I wonder, did that professor speak other languages herself? Could she share the experience of having to deal with?
I think she speaks Arabic at least.
Interesting.
I don't know about other, but at least Arabic.
But maybe someone with a knowledge of Romance languages would be able to figure out what you meant. But you can't expect that
because
it's a lingua franca situation.
Right. So you don't expect your interlocutor to have all the options laid out and figure out why what it comes from. Mm-hmm. And also as a professor, of course, she didn't have a lot of time to dig into the question why I asked specifically this.
Yeah, because it made perfect sense.
Yeah.
Except that it's not what you meant.
Except that it didn't make sense actually. Like, why would you ask? Why would you offer assistance if you haven't even met the person?
Yeah.
It's unfortunate, perhaps, that in that context it was actually plausible, because there is also research that's showing that if you hear a person with a non-native accent say something implausible, you are more likely to interpret it as plausible. And that's the research that Ted Gibson's lab in MIT shows. So, and they actually argue in their paper that perhaps non-native speakers actually have an advantage over native speakers because they are given the benefit of the doubt, given that they speak with their non-native accent and they might make errors, so you're more likely to interpret their implausible sentences as plausible.
Right, but that is because it was in a written mode and completely out of context in terms of your other speaker profile.
Yeah,
that we can't figure out where the rest of the factors, mm-hmm. I suppose. Right, good. So then are we always aware of errors, or how does it work?
Well, the research, it's an interesting question. So it looks like there are lots of things that we don't notice, and what I haven't said is that researchers describe this kind of processing as good enough language processing. So when good enough language processing is enough. So as Masha pointed out, Moses is close enough to Noah. So they come from the same semantic field, so it doesn't really matter which one you have in the sentence as long as it makes sense. So kind of being oriented to this global meaning is something that seems to be important for us. But there are certainly other things that we do notice. What do you think about it, Masha?
Yeah, maybe a flip of that question. So even if we are aware of errors or of variation and we have very strong judgments about them, what do we do about them? So there's an interesting, very recent dissertation by Daniel Lawrence about Yorkshire. You said this right? Because I'm not an English dialectologist and I'm very poor in imitating whatsoever. So he studied speech of Yorkshire residents, and he was studying language change in progress. And so there are different variables in this variety that are in contrast with, for example, standard English. So they would say instead of goat, they would say said it's pronounced as goat, right?
Something like that.
Mm-hmm. It's a more of a single single long vowel instead of mm-hmm. a diphthong-like thing that mm-hmm. We would have in American English, for mm-hmm. example. And so he interviewed people about it, and he found out that many had very strong judgments about it. They would recognize this as a feature of the local variety, and that some of them... And as a feature of local variety, it would be valued because it brings back to the question of identity, etc. But then even those who claimed to be Yorkshire born and bred, so manifestly adopting that Yorkshire identity in their speech, they would not necessarily use the local variety, and they would be shifting in that more standard English-like variety, and the younger the speakers were, the more prominent that shift would be. So you can be very much aware of certain things and claim it to be important for your identity, but nevertheless, your performance would not match it. So awareness and performance, for example, are linked in a very complex way and depends a lot on what particular variable and what particular language we're talking about and what particular group of speakers.
Right. Svetlana, do you have any examples for that?
Well, of awareness, perhaps nothing else comes to mind right now.
Right. So why are we so anxious about making mistakes?
If there are so many different things that we don't notice, why are we so anxious about making those? Perhaps I can give an example from my own family. My daughter speaks three languages, so we speak Russian at home, and then she learned Finnish in the daycare, and then English at school. There are all kinds of things that she might write or say in Russian, and for example, one thing that she says in Russian is, take a picture. This is perfectly fine in English, but in Russian it should be make a picture, not take a picture. Сделай фотографию. So this is clearly an example of cross-linguistic transfer. So she speaks English a lot at school and with her friends, and she's just transferring that phrase from her English to her Russian. Well, I'm a linguist. I know about cognitive processing. I know about identities. I know about multilingualism. English is lingua franca, non-native speech, everything. Do I correct my daughter's language? Yes. Why? Because she needs to speak proper Russian. Is it perfectly understandable what she says? Yes, it is. What kind of information does this reflect about her? Well, it reflects that she is a multilingual speaker who speaks not only Russian but also English. In principle, it's something that's considered an asset in today's society. So there is nothing, absolutely nothing bad in her saying, take a picture in Russian. Do I correct her language? Yes. Why? Because she needs to speak proper Russian. That's right. An example
Thank
of
you.
How
you... Well, yeah, that's interesting because, of course, to you as a mother and you knowing her linguistic profile, you can figure out what she actually means. But when you told me what she says, it actually also made sense. It was a bit like the example with the assist your classes. It actually means, yes, may I take your picture? Like... Yeah, I take the picture. But so for someone who is not familiar with her profile and someone who doesn't understand that she's multilingual, it actually means something else.
No, yeah, I may so be trying unconsciously to prevent a misunderstanding
yes,
in her
I think
future
maybe that
communication.
Is not only the question of being proper, but also the question of misunderstanding.
And then what's a proper language is such a difficult question. That
Yeah, we figured that we all have our own ideas about what proper means.
And our ideas about what proper means are just so entrenched.
Mm. Mm. Masha, what about you? Why are we so anxious? What do you think about it?
Well, it's here that the problem, I think, so your anxiety or you were not happy about that particular way of saying was because it made obvious that your daughter is not... Well, she's a native speaker, but that there's this transfer feature so that it's not proper Russian in the sense that it's got contaminated, let's say, by something else. That's what you didn't like. And you want your daughter's language to be as pure as someone who grows up in Russia to be, right? So we can be anxious about making mistakes because we... are afraid of being misunderstood, as you say. This is also an example of a potential source of misunderstanding, or because we don't want to be to make our linguistic performance make us appear as somebody we don't want to seem to other people. So, if you want to appear to other people as this. Bearer of standard language who is highly educated, then your anxiety would be related to making some non-standard features appear in your speech. Mm-hmm. If you are anxious about being to sound like a native speaker of the language and not some sort of foreigner, then you would be afraid of those transfer effects, contaminations, etc. So the whole idea is that it's not an error itself that makes us anxious. It's our linguistic or social linguistic self that we are trying to project. And if that projection doesn't match, or that intention doesn't match to what people actually hear from us, is what makes us anxious, probably.
Yeah. So it's the losing face.
Mm-hmm. Losing face, actually, in the sense, in a very sense of sort of mask, a sociolinguistic appearance, identity we're trying to communicate.
Right. So I think we are coming to an end of our discussion. And to conclude, we may argue that language errors may or may not lead to prediction errors in the brain. So we end up with a kind of double standards, again, coming back to standards of usage and standard of norm, what is understandable and what the brain can easily adapt to, yeah, versus what is prestigious or socially acceptable. And that, of course, brings us into the field of language ideologies, which we won't have time to discuss today, but that will be a good topic for another talk. So,